Buenas tardes, desde EOIO queremos dar la bienvenida a todos los que estáis aquí presentes y también los que nos siguen ahora mismo en directo a través de nuestra web. Esta es una clase que va a dar Mario Wenzel dentro del máster en Dirección de Empresas Industriales y Tecnológicas de Madrid. Mario Wenzel es formador y consultor de comunicación en inglés y os dejo directamente con él.
Okay, thank you very much, Marta. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the last of our series of English sessions in this master course this year. Okay. Today I want it to be a cultural day from the point of view of you telling me and I telling you about the different cultures and how culture affects the way we do business today. Okay? So today I would like very much that you get the feeling about how different cultures really are, how different they were a few, not so many years ago, 30, 40 years ago. Slowly they're merging together for good and for bad. The world is becoming globalized. The world is globalizing. Business world is globalizing. Leisure is globalizing. Personal lives are globalizing. And this affects the way we communicate. I usually tell you that these sessions are not about learning English. And even more today, I tell you and I remind you, I'm not interested in how you express yourself. I just want you to understand that English people, French people, Korean people that we're going to have today are going to be somehow they need to consider and they need to remember that we all come from different cultures and that you're going to have to do your business in a different country to the one you've been born, to where you've been born, and that you're going to have to consider and keep in mind all those different cultural aspects that definitely affect your communication. Okay? Just to give you a brief layout of what we're going to do today, we're going to be here until about 6 o'clock. Okay? Then we're going to continue with some of the contents concerning negotiations that we did from the last class. Okay? That I hope you've had time to work on. And then in the evening, in the last 3 hours, you're going to have a French business person who actually is currently living in Spain and he's very active doing business in Spain. And he's going to talk to us about doing business from the cultural point of view. And basically, he's going to be telling us anecdotes and experiences that he's had. And the same thing with a Korean person who's also been doing business in Spain for a very long time, considering the cultural point of view of his business. Okay, different backgrounds, different business sectors, but in the end, cultural aspects that have affected the way they have done business in the very long time. They both speak Spanish, they both speak English, and they both speak their native languages, which are French and Korean, and yet what they all have in common is the same thing, that they've had to learn to remember and understand and keep in mind all those aspects when it gets to doing business. Okay, so above all, everything about today, I'm feeling especially English today, and I hope I can transmit it to you from the point of view of all the things that I want to show you. You can understand humor, which is one of the parts that I've included here. I suppose you will not laugh. I will be the only person laughing here. Maybe not, but it will happen. And that means that you don't have the same humor as we have, okay? And that's what it's all about, being able to remember all those things, okay? Because in business, in Britain, humor is very important, okay? And many English people use British humor to do business. The problem is that some people, when they come here to Spain, they continue using British humor, and sometimes it's not welcomed or it's not understood in the same way. And this is something that has to be remembered, you know, because this works both ways. Spanish people have to remember that English people have this kind of humor, and English people have to remember that Spanish people. So somebody in England will probably be doing this same thing to English people about Spanish people. You know, this is the point, okay? Be aware that there are many aspects in life in where the culture will be done, okay? So, with no further delay, let's get on with, I hope everything, yes, okay, it works. Okay, as I said, today we're going to be talking about culture. Today we're going to be dealing with not only doing business, but with what our heritage is, what our parents gave us, and what our other, the parents of our parents brought down to us concerning specific values. And if you take a look at the definition of culture, you will see that there are many definitions of cultures, but some aspects which are specific and which are basic and fundamental about understanding culture is the fact that you've got a group of actions, a set of practices, a way of doing different things, whether it's a celebration, whether it's a reading, whether it's to go to work, that a group of people, and this is important, a group of people carry out based on a group of values and beliefs. You need to have values and you need to have beliefs in order to be considered a culture. Okay? If you don't have values and you don't have beliefs, you don't belong to any culture. You just do things. But cultures have these things in common. Okay? And it's got to be in a group. And the good thing about cultures is that these groups know, good evening, these groups know what you need to do in order to be accepted in this culture or not. Okay? Everybody here belongs to a culture. Okay? And that culture, you have specific values on many aspects of life. It could be religious aspects, it could be social aspects, it could be food, it could be celebrations, it could be music, it could be dancing. Okay? It could be about listening, it could be about reading, it could be about anything. But you need a set of values. So values and beliefs are very important here. And based on those values and beliefs is where you create a context. If you remember, in our last class, I believe I showed you a video about what's virgin mean. Didn't I show you a video? No, you don't remember? No? I showed you a video about a mother who was cooking and the girl who was doing her homework. I didn't show you that one? No? And I showed you the one about apologizing? No, I didn't show you the one about John Cleese and Monty Python? Okay. Yes, the Monty Python one. Okay, it's all about contexts, yes? Based on these beliefs and values, if you don't create the right context, you're not going to be understood. And it doesn't matter how good your English is or how good your Spanish, and if you speak the other person's language, if the context is not the same, you're going to be in trouble. And many times, these contexts are based on values and beliefs, okay? If I don't know what the values and beliefs of your culture are, I'm not going to understand anything you say. Or anything that I say, something that I say, could damage my reputation from your point of view. Okay? So, from the point of view of culture, and according to Walker, Walken, and Schmitz, there are three basic types of countries. Okay? Sorry, not of countries. Three cultural groups from the point of view of how you manage your business, okay? They're very distinct, and at the end of the day, most countries, and to be more precise, most cultures, they will belong, or they will show features from not just one, but maybe from two or even three of these groups over here, okay? You have your control-focused, you have your constraint-focused, and you have your harmony-focused, okay? Three objectives that most communities mainly look at, okay? Now, what's the difference between them? And I've just put a country so you can see and you can quickly identify, try to identify how those communities work, okay? The controlled focus communities are worried about measuring. They're worried about analyzing. They're worried about why things happen. They want to find out why everything happens, okay? So they measure everything, they analyze, they register, they give a lot of feedback, they're in continuous communication, and they want to know even more and more and more. They're very rational communities. For example, USA, okay? Then you have other countries or other cultures that are more harmony focused. And harmony means that they want all of their constituents and all of the individuals making the group to be happy. But to be happy based on pragmatic, real needs to be covered. So they want everybody to have a job. They want everything to be fair. The legal system is very, how can I say, unflexible, it's very strict. Equality is very important. But from the point of view of making everybody happy, you've got your role, and that role you should carry out. For example, Germany is a country where this happens continuously, okay? To other cultures, those cultures seem very monotonous. Everything, life is always the same. Life is boring. But there is a very high state of welfare among the inhabitants of those countries, yes? So they're happily bored, we could say. Whereas in other countries, where it is the last group, which maybe could be the most distant opposite to this group, people are worried about constraints. Constraint in the words. You understand constraint as in handicap, problems, obstacles, okay? And so people try to somehow get away from those constraints without analyzing them. They don't want to know why they've got constraints. They don't even analyze and ask themselves where they have those constraints. In fact, many of those constraints are divine. They are overpowered. They are overwhelming, almighty constraints, which in many times, and in most cases, are accepted. Because these people accept those constraints with a blind eye. They just accept it. I have a problem? I know. This has been a terrible year? I know. I'm not going to look back. I'm just going to carry on. Okay? They're very religious countries and cultures. And they're very communicative cultures. They share a lot of things. They're very forward-going people. Some look back, but generally they don't look back. They just look forward. No looking back because they don't even analyze. They don't worry about analyzing. Okay, this has happened. I don't want it to happen again. I'm going to try something else, for example. Okay? And so Mediterranean, Arabian, Middle East countries share this common trait. Okay? So obviously from now, you begin to think automatically, where's Spain? Where's England in these three countries? Where do you think Spain is in these three countries? And I mean the current Spain, yes? We could say that from the point of view of business, Spain in the last 50 years has changed more than in the last 5,000 years, okay? And so from that point of view and from the globalizing point of view, Spain is a completely new country, yes, okay? But basically, where do you think Spain belongs? Good. Harmony focused and maybe constraint focused. In fact, its origins are in the constraints, okay? But it's slowly been moving and changing into a harmony focus, okay?
But do you mean Spain or do you mean Madrid? Because I think it's completely different.
Okay, I know why you know that it's completely different, because you know the Spanish population very well. And what happens in Spain happens in every single country, north and south, east and west, yes? Well, you've got that in England. You've got that in Scotland. You've got that in Wales. You've got that in Ireland. So today, which is supposedly British culture, I can say that Scottish and British are completely different. And Irish and Welsh are completely different. Not only in the drinking, but in many other things, they're completely different. So that's going to happen. But one thing that keeps a Catalonian close to an Andalusian are certain cultural values. You don't agree?
No.
Okay.
Because I was referring more that these cities as Madrid, people in there, the behavior of the people in there is completely different to the rest of the people. It's not only a matter of north, south, east, and west. It's a matter of belonging to a big city has a completely different view of the life compared to other small cities.
Okay.
Close to Madrid.
And that gives you cultural values?
Yes.
Okay. The open-minded is one of the actions. Okay, in fact, afterwards, there's going to be a group of values on which we're going to base today's talk, and in which both Gilan and Jai are going to speak to us afterwards, so that you can see what Spanish people think, what English people think, what French people think, what Korean people think, okay, from the point of view of all this. Okay, and obviously, cultural values, there are millions. Okay, and indeed, something that is happening today is that cultures are creating subcultures and sub-subcultures, which more and more differentiate groups of individuals within a main cultural group. Okay, and that's something that's going to happen. Okay, but as I say, not only in Spain, but also in many places. Basically, what you're saying is that you think that people, for example, generalizing, in Andalusia are more religious than people in Madrid, for example, from the point of view of that they accept constraints in a different way to the way people in Madrid would accept constraints. Good. And I'm sure that in Andalusia, there would also be people who don't accept constraints, and they're going to be thinking and analyzing many things. Because in the end, what this means is that there are successful companies in China, in Spain, in Ghana, in Botswana, in Mozambique, in, yes, everybody's smiling with Botswana, yes. I wanted to say it, but I know everybody's laughing. And in the USA, in Peru, everywhere. There's successful companies everywhere, and they're all from different cultures. So what does that mean? Well, it means that at some point, those cultures are able to deliver what they're expected to deliver. So it doesn't mean that only the USA has successful companies, only Japan has successful companies, only Spain, Britain, Germany has successful companies. No. In all countries, you have successful and unsuccessful companies. So this is common to all cultures. And this is something important, okay? Okay, so this is a very interesting point of view that Mr. Lewis has created in order to somehow classify the countries from the point of view of how you tend to decide. And it's good that I see people smiling as you look at it, because you're identifying many trends, many things, okay? And the point about this is that this is true. This is what happens. This is it. Okay? And if you take a look, he's basically done three groups. Yes? You've got the multi-active, the linear active, and the reactive communities. Yes? And of course, you've got a continuum between those three points, creating a kind of triangle in which you could classify the different countries. And now everybody looks for their own country and says, oh, here we are. Okay? And something which is quite interesting is that the countries which are near the edges, near the corners, are usually successful countries. Yes? Okay? So, and I said near the corners, not right on the corners, but near the corners. Yes? So you may look at one or two, yes, Spain is near the corner, yes? So wow, a successful country.
Like Greece and Portugal.
Yes, Greece and Portugal. Cyprus, wow. Yeah. Okay. So, as you can see, he classifies in a different way linear active countries as those active that are similar to the control-focused countries that we said before. Yes, they are focused on facts, they're very pragmatic countries, yes, and they take lots of decisions based on the many facts that they collect and the many analyses that they do. Okay, all right? So that's why you've got USA down there, you've got Germany, Switzerland, okay? And on the other hand, on the other side, you've also got UK, okay? Sweden, Latvia. So Anglo-Saxon culture is somewhere around there, yes? On the other hand, you've got the multi-active countries, yes? Countries that are capable of doing many things at the same time. They improvise a lot. They also plan, but they plan knowing that they're going to do many things. There is a general concept about, oh, if you plan, you don't improvise, and if you improvise, you don't plan. And yet, I think you can do both things. And in fact, both things have good and not so good aspects about it. But, okay, so these, as I said before, are countries that are very emotional, very communicative. They share a lot of information, okay? And so that's why you've got many Mediterranean, South American, African countries, okay? And then you've got the reactive community. The reactive community are very quiet people, difficult communications, respect for the other is of utmost importance, okay? And especially, they like to learn from people by listening to the other part. Okay, so it's very difficult to communicate with them, but they can also be very successful. And so you have all these countries in the middle, which, knowing who you're doing business with, from this point of view, you should be able to decide many things as to the approach of the negotiation, the approach of the meeting. And in fact, if we join this to the aspects of negotiations that we did in our last session, and which were the basis of how you needed to structure the assignment that you had for this session, it would be very interesting to understand how you can make your puzzle and establish your conditions of all the factors that you need to include in your negotiation. Okay, so again, a very interesting way of trying to include countries within some kind of cultural groups, okay? Do you agree with Spain's position over there? By the way, do you know where Mr. Lewis is from? Where do you think Mr. Lewis is from? Maybe from the distribution of this?
USA?
USA? He's UK, actually, okay? He's British, okay? In fact, he would say he's English, not British, okay? But he's English, okay? Agree with Spain's position? Or do you think, for example, I'm not talking so much about up along this line, I'm talking more about probably on this line. Would Spain be more here or here? What do you think? From your, as a Spaniard that you are. So you would keep it on the same side, yes? Left side? Yeah? Okay. More than reactive. I think it would be impossible for somebody from Spain to be reactive, yes? Just by looking at this, yes? This, you're very, like, forward people. You're not reactive. You act immediately, yes? Okay, so there's no way. I would not imagine comparing a Spaniard with a Japanese, you know, or a Korean, who are more courteous, more reactive, waiting, yes? Yes, but open-minded is not the same as being reactive, okay?
Yeah.
Okay? It's amazing how, if we really started to analyze how many values and how many aspects you could consider from the point of view of doing an intercultural business situation, I could get you more than 100 factors, which would be amazingly interesting to analyze, and that you would say, as soon as I tell you that factor, you would say, I understand what you mean. In this situation, I identified this factor. And in this situation, I saw this other factor. And I noticed that when I was with another person from another nationality, this happened. And indeed, Japanese people are open-minded as well. For example, open-mindedness sometimes is considered to be completely the opposite of traditional people. And it's not. Because, for example, British people are, I believe, open-minded people, and yet they're very traditional people. I've got my father's lawnmower. He gave it to me. He passed it on to me, like many fathers do. Traditional people, but at the same time, you accept and you try to see the advantages of new ideas, new trends, new ways of doing things, okay? But that doesn't mean that you are somehow, you wait, you respect, and until you don't know what the other person likes, then you do that so that he's not harmed or he doesn't feel ashamed in any way, okay? UK, today we'll be dealing about UK. Do you agree with UK's position or would you put it in a different place? Yes? Surprisingly, UK on this side instead of that side, or not surprising? In fact, if you look at this, this is a very interesting little corner over here, isn't it? Because you've got countries which could be considered similar in many ways, and yet afterwards, at the end of the day, for example, Germany and the UK are very, very, very different, okay? Very different, okay? And then you've got countries such as Finland and Estonia, or even Canada, that are moving on to this side over here. Surprisingly, you know, you would think these, at least from the general concepts that people have about Northern European people, and yet there they are, okay? So anyway, very interesting slide, which connects to this one from the point of view of what do companies look for when they're managing a business? Which approach, which decisions do they take, and based on what? Okay? And what they try to do, and this is another classification that has been done, is to choose between one end of a continuum and another end of the continuum, okay? To choose between very different positions, which in the end will help them to obtain the result that they want. For example, you can be a process-oriented company, or we want a result-oriented company. What do you prefer? Sorry, not what do you prefer. What do you usually do? Result. Okay, everybody results? Yes? Okay, good. All right. Results. No matter what the process is. Everything goes? Everything counts? All is good? Everything can be done? Yes? Okay, this is where morale comes in many times. Yes? And of course, this is where efficiency and efficacy also come in, okay? But this is one of the choices that people have, okay? Another choice that people have is whether my company will be employee-orientated or job-orientated. What's more important for me, the human factor or the task that I need to do, okay? What do you think? What's your opinion? Job-oriented, okay. I'm not gonna say is that good or bad, but how does it show? How does it show if it's job and not so much employee? In which way does it show that it's job-oriented? What things do you see that happen?
I think
the results. Okay, so he looks at, do you think people or companies protect the workers? Yes? No? Okay, different, good, this is the point. And of course, you know what happens? Maybe 30 years ago, most companies would be very similar in Spain. But now, I think companies have changed enormously, and there is a great variation between some and other companies. Yes? Whereas maybe 30, 40 years ago, they were very similar. But now there is a great change. And I'm sure there will be companies that are more employee-orientated and some companies that would be job-oriented. Okay? Right. Amateur versus professional, as in commitment, dedication that you take, and qualifications of the people that you employ to perform a specific task. Some people decide anybody can learn something and they can, and I don't need specialized people to do it. And other people say, I want to be as specialized as possible because the more specialized I am, the better I will do something. Yes? This is something that here in Spain, for example, has been quite, it's quite clear. What do you think about the level of specialization here in Spain in companies or even in the training that people receive? Specialized or not specialized? Not specialized. Good. And this is a cultural aspect about Spain. Even from university. Yes? And this is no... I'm not criticizing or anything, but you just look at the number of subjects that students have in the years just before university. And you look at the number of subjects that in other countries students have just before university. Okay? And even before the Bologna plan came in, university in Spain was 5 years, yes? Whereas in other countries, it was 4 or 3 years, and it had been for a long time. Yes, okay? So specialization is a fact in many other countries, okay? Whereas not so much here. Okay, open system, closed system. This refers to, open and closed can refer to many, many different classifications and many criteria. But basically, it refers to the fact that an open system is an open-minded and accepts different points of view and accepts flexibility at some point, whereas a closed system is well-defined from the beginning and will continue with the same procedure throughout, no matter what happens. Okay, this is basically it. What do you think it's like in Spain? What do you think? Or is there a bit of everything? It depends on the company? Yeah? Okay, all right. Do you think it would be an open system? Open system, yeah. Improvisation, yes. See how things go and then we'll decide. First we commit and then we see how we solve the problem. But we'll always be able to solve the problem, don't worry about it, which is an excellent attitude. And it's an excellent capacity, eh? The assurance and the confidence that you will be able to solve whatever comes along is an excellent attitude, which many cultures do not train or do not teach their people, okay? Okay, loose control, tight control, flexibility, understanding, negotiating capacity, ready for the unexpected, okay? What do you think in Spain? Loose? I'm not going to talk so much about Spain. Yeah, well, I'm going to talk about Spain. But as I meant at the beginning, more of the cultural group where Spain is. Okay? Loose or tight? Registers, logs, feedback, or not? Sorry?
Yeah, more and more.
More and more?
Yeah.
Okay. But originally, the origins, we're not so, okay, not that much control, okay? And last one, pragmatic versus normative. Either, is it legal or not legal what I'm doing? Or, I just care about doing it and don't worry about it. We need to carry it along, okay? So I'm more concerned about, you know, am I complying with the law? Am I being able to make sure that everything is according to the books? Or I just want to get this thing going? What do you think about Spain in this case? Sorry? Pragmatic. Yeah, definitely. Definitely pragmatic. Clearly pragmatic. Yes? And again, that has some good points. Okay? So, you know, one of the general things that I want you to see about this is not, there is no point in considering, oh, this is for good and this is for bad, this culture is better. No, that's not the point here. The point here is that in every culture, in every region, in every country, there are successful companies. There are successful companies which are results-based, and there are successful companies with a loose control. So there's a bit of everything. And this is the whole point. But the whole point about this is that when negotiating, when doing business, when taking decisions, it helps to consider who you're working with. Okay? Okay, so this is a very important concept that I try to explain to people, and that clearly differentiates many cultures. And I want you to analyze it, and I want you to think about these situations, especially now between Spanish and British cultures, okay? And it's four groups of factors that I've, from experience and from what I have seen and how I've seen that companies do business, affect the way people perceive a situation. And that's why I call them situational continuums, because it's like a very subtle, very mild line along which people many times confuse where they are. First factor that I'm going to talk about is between rude and polite. People considering being rude and considering being polite. What do you consider being rude, and what do you consider being polite? And different cultures have different concepts about this. And for some reason, in Spanish and in English cultures, the concepts are very different. Yes? Irrespectively of whether there is this topic about English people being like extremely, extremely, you know, polite, and you don't need to be so polite. In fact, they're so polite, they're pompous, and they're stuck up, okay? But irrespective of that, there is a truth in which rudeness and politeness here in Spain are mixed with many of the other, and confused with many of the other factors, okay? I'm not only talking about please and thank you, I'm also talking about how you say things. Because, for example, one thing which is different between British culture and Spanish culture is that most probably in British culture, the packaging is more important than the content. How you say something is more important than what you're going to say. Which here in Spain is considered in many occasions a lie, or a euphemism, or to be politically correct, or something like that, okay? Whereas here in Spain, people tend to appreciate clarity when you're speaking. Yes? Or not true? Is that, do you agree or not? Yes, in general, okay? One thing I do appreciate is that try to leave aside your heart when you answer, okay? Considering, I don't know if you're all Spanish here. Everybody Spanish here? No? Where are you from? Argentina. Anybody else? Jordan?
Romania.
Okay, good, excellent. So, multicultural today. Brilliant. All speak English, no problem, yes? Okay, all right. Being polite here in Spain, it's an option. And when there are situations where things don't go your way, or when you need to complain, or when you need to show to the other party that you don't agree with them, that politeness can be reduced. In these cases, you can see, I've put the slider, I consider this like a situational equalizer, where I can just move up and down, yeah, and I can say, okay, I want to be polite today, or I want to be rude, and I just move it up and down. Well, in England, it's not an option. In England, you put it there, and you lock it there, and you leave it there. And it doesn't matter if you don't understand, if you don't agree, if you're angry, if you're tired, if you're losing, you've got to be polite, okay? Which doesn't mean being cool, you've just got to be polite, okay? Let me show you the next ones, formal and informal, okay? Formal in England is a question of vocabulary. It's a very artificial situation, nothing more, okay? Being informal means that you can use other kind of language. So if you've got good vocabulary, you can be formal. If you've got not so good vocabulary, you will be dealing in an informal way. Irrespective of whether you're polite or rude. So you can be rude and formal, and you can be rude and informal. Okay? So if you go to a hotel and you've got a reservation and you say, good evening, I've got a reservation for two nights, two rooms. What will they say to you at the front desk if they want to find out who you are? How will they ask you your name? What do you think? Sorry?
I didn't have your name.
I didn't hear your name. 20 press-ups, 40 sit-ups, and then we can start talking. Any other options?
Yeah, something like, can I excuse me, please, could you tell me your name?
Good. Now, can I have your name? May I have your name? Could you tell me your name? Now we're getting nearer. What's your name? Many people, you know? Here in Spain, especially because they say one of the first things you learn in English is, what is your name? So if this is what I learn, this is what I say. Yes? What's your name? Nobody in England asks you your name like that. Nobody in England would say, what's your name? Because you're being rude. Yes? The only situation where somebody could say, what's your name, would be a policeman to somebody who thinks has been doing something. Or a teacher to a student, what's your name? As a clear identification of an individual. But there is no personal contact. So people can start saying, may I have your name? Can I have your name? Okay? All right? Could you tell me your name? Okay, can you tell me your name? And if you realize between can you tell me your name? Could you tell me your name? Would you tell me your name? May I have your name? What do you think is more formal? May I have your name? Could you tell me your name? Which one do you think is more formal? Why? Why does it sound, what's the feeling you get when may I have your name? Good. When you say, could you give me your name, you're telling him to do something. When you say, may I have your name, you're asking him if he would be so kind for you to hear his name, but I'm not telling you to do anything. You can tell me the way you want, but I'm not asking you to do something. Now this is very subtle. There's a very small difference, but between may I have, can I receive, and can you give me, there's a big difference. Okay? Now, from the point of view of formality, I can move over here, yeah? No problem? Good. There's something which people don't realize. We have a limitation, or an apparent initial limitation. You in English means four things. What does it mean? How can it be that a language with only one word for these four things can be so polite and so formal? Because when we say you, we say you. We have no usted, we have no tú. And yet, people consider English people, British people, polite. Well, and we can become formal. And we can become rude and formal. For example, goodness gracious, young man, your haircut is absolutely atrendous, I say to the young man. Am I being formal or informal? I'm being very formal. Am I being rude or polite? What's the point of me telling him that he's ugly? There's no point. I'm being rude, but I'm being formal. Do not confuse it. I could also say, leave off, mate. What a fucking haircut you've got there. Fucking hell, who's done it? I'm being informal and rude. Okay? So I can mix all those things continuously. And I'm going to keep on mixing them when I show you the rest of the other two values that I have there. But the point is that if I want to speak to him as a usted or as a tú, I have my tools in English. Not with the you, because I've only got one word, but with other words. So not only the context, but the words themselves give me a usted. How can I tell a can you into an usted? Okay, or even more, would you? As simple as that, it's a basic rule. Would you? How can I turn a can I into an usted? May I? Can I have your name? ¿Me puedes dar tu nombre? May I have your name? ¿Me puede dar su nombre? How do you say cómo estás in English? Sorry? No? How do you do is cómo está usted? How are you is cómo estás? Okay? How are you doing is cómo está usted? Yeah? So imagine I say, good morning, sir, how do you do? Imagine I say, what's up? Okay? It's as simple as that. And when I say, what's up, am I being rude? How can I be rude if I'm greeting you? I can't be rude if I greet you. Do you understand? Are you beginning to understand how you can be one thing and be the other? And it's got nothing to do with each other. You can be whatever you want every morning. You just slide your equalizer and say, today, I'm just going to be what's up and I'm going to tell everybody about their haircuts. Or, today, I'm going to be rather stuck up and I'm going to tell people in a very formal way that I want to be polite. Okay? Next option, relaxed, demanding. This is something that here in Spain, and in many similar cultures, people believe that to be demanding is to be rude. Yes? For example, I need the report at 10 o'clock. So don't forget. That's the situation, okay? So you say, whoa, 10 o'clock, I've only got 3 hours. You're being rude because I've only got 3 hours. Okay? We don't believe you're being rude. We believe you're being demanding. So how could you be polite? Because you've always got to be polite and demanding. Can anybody give me an option as to how you would say that? How can you send an email to a group of people in which you say, listen, mate, you've got 3 hours, and in 3 hours, I want it.
It would be nice if the report is in my desk by...
Good. It would be nice if... Is that demanding? Really? It would be nice if. And I receive it would be nice if, and I would write, thank you very much, young man, but it's not going to be nice for you. Because you give me the option. It would be nice if, and it's not going to be nice. So you're not being demanding.
That's a double sense.
Okay.
It means that it has to be there.
Okay, so how can you be demanding?
I would,
conditional. Yeah. You're moving up, but you're still relaxed. Demanding, for God's sake, demanding.
Can I have?
No, you can't.
It is absolutely necessary.
Good, now you're being demanding. But you move this way. You have to send me your report after doing your 20 press-ups and 50 sit-ups. Send me your report. You see? You must, have to. Yeah, is the list of modal verbs. Now everybody takes out the list of modal verbs and start thinking, okay, possibility, obligation, must, have to, okay. It's not as simple as that. There is one of the best inventions of mankind. No, more than that. In my opinion, together with the dummies, los chupetes, this is the second best invention in mankind. The passive, which Spanish people do not use when they speak, but English people use continuously. The good thing about the passive is that nobody does anything. No. Things are done, but nobody does anything. Okay? So, I would say report must be handed in by 10 o'clock today.
And I would say it's not my...
Good. So, report must be handed in. And one of the things that we will see in one of the comment, in one of the aspects for in culture is liability. Whose responsibility is it for this task to be performed? Yours. Okay, so I'm not asking you to do it. I am telling you that this has to be done. Do you see the difference between that? Do you see the relationship with may I have and can you give me? It's exactly the same. May I have is things are to be done. Yes? So, in Spain, it's very direct that somebody should do something. That somebody should do something. Even though in Spanish you can say, el informe será entregado antes de las 10. Okay, good, not bad. It's the same kind of idea, okay? But for some reason, people do not tend to communicate in that way because that is considered impersonal in Spain. It's a machine talking to me. I've got a boss, not a machine. Whereas in England, it could be considered as I've got a demanding boss. It's not impersonal, I consider it demanding. Okay? So, demanding is another one of those things where you can be relaxed or demanding. So, 6 months before you need something, you could say things I'm not going to write because then everybody will understand. I would appreciate if you could kindly send us the report by January the 7th. Looking forward to your reply, blah, blah, blah. I've locked it because I'm formal. Formal or informal? Formal, demanding or relaxed? Very relaxed. I would appreciate. And if you don't, I will not appreciate it. But if you do, I will appreciate it. If you could or if you would. If, conditionals, appreciations, very relaxed. Okay? 3 months later, no reply. So I need to get more demanding. I still want to be formal. So I would need to start saying something like, considering the lack of communication I've received from your side, would appreciate if you could send. So, I still use the formula, would appreciate if you could send, but considering the fact that I've... So I leave everything very clear. You have an answer to me, but I still need it. I'm not being very demanding, but I'm telling them that they haven't replied. Okay? 2 months later, only 1 month to go, still no reply. Now I begin to get away from any kind of conditional, get away from any you would appreciate. And now I begin to say something such as what? 1 month, eh? It's not 1 week, 1 month. So I, you know, what could I say? Any ideas, any proposals? Okay, remember, I want to be more demanding. Okay. With only 3 weeks to go, or with only 4 weeks to go, I still have received no news from you. And I am beginning to be in urgent need of your documents. Okay? I am beginning to be in urgent need of. Very formal. Okay? It's still very polite, but I'm being demanding. Okay? 2 weeks, and I need to insist more, and I need to be more demanding. Please remember, we must receive documents by Monday, blah, blah, blah. Please remember, we must receive, okay? Is that formal or informal? Please remember, I must receive. What is it? What do you think? Formal? Please remember, I must receive. Very informal. Now I've gone completely informal, yes? Now, 1 week before, now I need to be very polite, more than ever. And the point is that I'm probably as angry as ever because I still haven't received it. And it is precisely in these moments that I need to be as polite as I can. Even though I've heated up, I need to be polite, which is what many cultures confuse. Okay? And this is what here, you can see that it's completely independent. And this is where, because I need to be demanding and I need to be formal, the next factor comes in. And the next factor is, do I want to be close? Do I want to be distant? In some cultures, being close means I'm relaxed. Hey, he's my friend. He'll understand. No worry. Take it easy. You know. Oh, sorry. You know. Whereas in other cultures, it's so independent, it's got nothing to do with it. You know, I can be your acquaintance. I can have an email with you every week, but I still need those documents, and I'm going to be demanding. So in many cultures, mixing closeness with informality is like, oh, it's the same thing. I can be close, and close means I need to be informal. So I can be informal with my colleague who sits on the table next to me. So if I need him to send me a report, I would say, come on, John, give it to me. I still haven't got it. But that's not the point. I can still ask John for a report urgently. John, please be reminded, report must be on my table by 10 o'clock. You see? John, please be reminded, passive. I'm not reminding you. You are reminded. Okay? Report, why do you put that face? Because it's the same thing.
Yes, it's the same thing.
Good, okay. Because some cultures do not perceive that difference, whereas other cultures, there is an importance between saying, please be reminded, than saying, I remind you, which is completely different. Okay, very different. Report must be handed in by 10. I'm not saying you've got to give me the report by 10. So, if I want to be close, I put I, you, we. And if I want to be distant, I don't put anybody. Report must be handed in. And I go back to the passive, which is a very useful invention. Okay? So in English, continuously, you're going to be dealing with all these kinds. I'm going to move it this way. We're going to be dealing with all of these kinds of situations where one day I decide to be informal and another day I decide to be demanding. And some days my use will be tú and my use will be usted. And based on that, it will be, I will use some words or other words. And it's completely independent. I can be polite, sorry, I can be formal with you and I can be formal with my wife. And I can be formal with my parents, and I can be formal with anybody who walks along the street. And I can be distant with my parents, and I can be distant with my colleague, and I can be distant with somebody in the street. And I can't be close to somebody in the street, but I can be close to my colleagues, and I can be close to somebody. Or maybe I can be close to somebody in the street. But in some cultures, trying to become close to somebody in the street is seen as an offense, whereas in other cultures, it's okay. In Spain, what is it like to try and be close with people on the street? Is it okay? Is it accepted? Absolutely. In fact, it is desired. Yes? People like it. Remember, it was a very communicative, eloquent cultures. They communicate, they exchange a lot of ideas. They like it. In some countries, if somebody comes up to you in the street and tells you something, you're like surprised. If your neighbor speaks to you, you're surprised. Here in Spain, neighbors are always speaking. They always communicate. And that has many advantages. Yes? Okay. So, do you understand the fact that you can talk about anything you want, you can behave in any situation with these four situational continuums in a very independent way? And one of the advantages of your attitude would be to be able to master a language so that you can feel that you're acting formal, relaxed, and distant. Notice that I'm leaving out rude and polite, because you're always going to be polite. Or you can be close, relaxed, and informal. Or you can be formal, demanding, and distant. And it's got nothing to do with each other. This is a very useful exercise that when I try to show people how they can improve their English communications by thinking in English, there are many people who've got an excellent vocabulary and they've got a wonderful mastery of their verbs and all their modals and everything, but because they confuse, for example, informal with close, the way they act in a situation is not the most adequate. And it's not a matter of language, it's a matter of culture. It's a matter of my context and your context is not the same. I think I'm being informal and I'm being close. And in a culture such as a British one, trying to be close in a certain moment is not considered very adequate. Okay? Right? So, very clear idea. Okay? Let's move on now to the nitty-gritty of all of this, which is the 10 aspects that we're going to be dealing with. Okay? With, let me just make sure that I've got my slides as well. With very specific aspects of the hundreds that I said before, I think 10, which in the end can somehow include many of the others, okay? And then again, Walker, Walker and Schmitz, in this case, have given this classification, which they believe is quite useful and can be applied, okay? Talking with, for example, the environment. And the environment is the way that people perceive how things happen in your surrounding. Why things are in one place, why things are in another place, why in a city a company is in one place and another company is in another place, okay? And all this, for example, is very different between Spanish and English people from the point of view of order, okay? You know the typical messy table that many people have, which apparently seems unorganized, but really is not unorganized. It will be unorganized for somebody who is not at that table, but the person who works at that table knows precisely where every single item is. Correct? That happens to all of us, yes? Don't agree?
People think they know where the things are, but they know for real.
Good, because in the end, it is true that a messy table
is a mess
and runs more risks of not knowing where your things are than if you've got an organized table. Okay, good. Could be a possibility. In fact, it's quite true. Yes, all right, good. And things are changing. And in fact, performance increases when there is order. And this is clear. Yes, okay, all right. So, no?
Yes.
Good. So it's a very obvious thing. Okay. Second things. Time and how people identify, let me put this forward so you can see the other one, and now you can see better, okay? How people perceive time, how people manage time, how people consider time. It's such an enormous difference between Mediterranean cultures and British countries. It's so big. For example, easy, today's agenda. Meeting at 10 o'clock. lunch. And when does the meeting finish? When we finish speaking? When we agree? In England, you have meeting begins at 10 o'clock, meeting finishes at 11 o'clock, or meeting finishes at 2 o'clock, or meeting finishes at 10:30. But you have a beginning and an end. That in Spain is considered a big constraint. It's considered abusive. It's considered aggressive. Or not? No? Oh, good. Excellent. Well, good. I mean, I'm glad to hear somebody who's... The way you do businesses, the way you do meetings is that way?
Yes.
Beginning and end? Good. Anybody else who does a beginning and end to a meeting?
Yeah, but it never happens.
This is the second question that I was going to pose. Now, you've got an agenda to follow. You've got a schedule. Do you follow it or not? Yes? Do you comply with it? No? Good. Okay. Okay, you try. Good. But does it work?
Sometimes.
Okay, sometimes. And maybe more and more. But the point is that I still see in many places that people say, okay, sorry, I've got a meeting at 10 o'clock. Or in England, for example, they give you a phone call. Hi, have you got a minute? And they say, yes, I can speak to you until 10:15. If you say that in Spain to somebody on the phone, they say, you know, you're being rude because I've called you and you need to speak to me. No, I can speak to you, but I've only got so much time. Can you organize your message so that we can have the conversation in this much time? Yes, we carry on speaking. No, I'll call you another time. Or I'll just give you a brief outline of what I want. And I hang up, and then I'll continue by email or in another moment. Okay? When I came here to Spain, and I went out with my friends, they said, hey, when shall we meet? Let's go out for a drink. Okay, I'll see you at 10:25. 10:25? No, in Spain you meet at 10 o'clock or 10:30. There is nothing in between. It's true. Or do you meet with your friends at 10:48? When do you meet? 10? 10:30? Anybody meets at 10:15? Nobody meets at 10:15. It doesn't exist as far as appointments and meetings with your friends are. In England, you meet at 10:10, even with your friends, eh? When should we go out for dinner? 10:10. All right then, fair enough. And this is just a social event, so you're not even very strict about time from the point of view of managing time, but you know that you're going to, you know, it's not strange. So it took me some time to realize that I only had two options, 10:00 and 10:30. And in the meantime, something in the middle, I had to arrange my time, okay? This is how people arrange time. This is the big cultural differences in times between Britain and Spain. Okay, all right? Another example, we meet at 10 o'clock, good. I know you're going to meet at 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock, I'm on my way. On my way. Good. You know, it's like precise. On my way where? On my way could be anything between I'm walking into the shower right now, so I'm going to take about 1.5 hours, to I've just locked my door, to I'm just outside the restaurant and I'll be there in 5 minutes. Any of that could be on my way. And on top of that, I'm on my way, you tell me at 10 o'clock. You don't tell me at 9:45. No, you tell me at 10 o'clock. Why? Because I met with you at 10 o'clock. So if I meet at 10 o'clock, I was supposed to be there at 10 o'clock, so I call you at 10 o'clock. I'm not there, but my voice is, so I'm not late. It makes sense. It's the right time management, you know? Obviously, I'm exaggerating the situation. I'm just so that people understand. This is not like that all the time, but I can assure you that I've been called many times at 10 o'clock saying, sorry, I'm late. I know you're late. You're calling me. I can see it. I know. So why do you call me at 10 o'clock? You should call me when you knew that you were going to be late. But it's very difficult. It's not usual. Or you tell me. Is it usual for people to call when they know they're going to be late in the moment? And they say, I'm going to be about 30 minutes behind schedule, so I better call now to say that I'm going to be late. Is that usual or not?
No, I don't even bother to
call. Okay, you don't even bother. So what do? You just turn up when you turn up.
Yeah.
Good.
They know.
Good. And they accept it, no problem. Yeah? No olives for you. You go straight into the first course or the main course. And
what people usually do, they arrange the meeting 1 hour ahead. So
knowing that You're going to be there. Oh, okay, that's the other one. Good. Okay, yeah. So you arrange ahead. Okay. Obviously, there are situations where you can't do that. Yes, okay. But that's another way of showing how time management is very different between one culture and the other one. Okay, all right. Okay, action. How, let me just make sure. How people act in a given situation based on what decisions they're going to take. Yes? And the way people take decisions are very different in many different cultures. Mediterranean countries are hot countries where people have the capacity to decide very quickly. I'm not saying that's being impulsive, because usually when you, the basic definition of impulsive means that you take a decision, because you obviously take a decision of doing something, but without considering many of the factors, you just take a decision. Whereas when you take a decision quickly, it means that you've considered the factors and you've taken a decision based on that criteria, which is good. So taking decisions quickly can many times be very useful. British don't do that. British take a long time to reach a decision. They do. They always do. They take it easy. Yes? And this exasperates many other cultures, to the point that they think they are being ignored by the British. And it's not the case. The case is that they want to make sure that everything is clear, especially, and I'm sure that in many projects you will have noticed, concerning liabilities. Concerning liabilities, British people will leave nothing to luck. They will absolutely try and control everything. And obviously this means that if they don't like what they've got, or if the other party doesn't like what they've got, there's got to be a renegotiation. And this means that you've got to talk about it again, think for more options. So when you think everything is done, it's very possible that in a meeting, people will say, oh no, but don't forget this. Ooh, and how can we go around this? Okay, we need a couple of days to think about this. Meeting stops, and then you go back again. That doesn't mean that things are going backwards. No, it just means that you need time to make sure that you comply with all the aspects that both parties would like to meet. Okay? Here in Spain, and in many similar cultures, what happens many times is that first you take the decision and you say, yeah, we're going to do this project. And then there's meetings to say, how are we going to move this forward? How are we going to get it doing? How are we going to get it going? How are we going to make sure that we overcome these problems and these handicaps? And so you find certain dynamics in meetings, which are problem-solving meetings, of things that have appeared once the decision has been taken. Yes? And in many cases, as I said at the beginning, they are solved. They are solved, and people have the capacity and show the capacity to solve those problems. But the decision is taken, and then teamwork begins, considering all the aspects. Whereas in Britain, it will take a long time for everybody to agree, and then the decision will be taken. Yes? Which means that sometimes, because you've got the constraint of a deadline, here, the deadline is like a very important factor, whereas over there, the deadline is not that important. Yes? If we can't do it, we can't do it. And they're not going to present any bid or tender because they know that they're not going to have even enough time to evaluate the possibility of doing that, because they're going to need so much time for this, so much time for this, so much time for this evaluation. Okay? Whereas many times in the constrained focus countries, first they say, yeah, we're going to do it, let's go and do it. Okay? And then, yeah, we're going to comply with this, we're going to comply. How are we going to comply with this? Oh, okay. Now we need to stop and think and do it. But we've got to do it because we've got it. Okay? And it's a big difference. Okay? It's a very big difference. Okay? So that's one of the things about action and about actions, which are very different. Communications. In the slide before about the situational continuums, it was very clear that communication, how people communicate, is very different in both cultures. Okay, one clear example, for example, in meetings, even when you meet somebody for the first time. Good morning. How do you do? My name is Mario Wenzel. I work for EOI. Pleasure meeting you. The other person introduces himself to me, and immediately from the very first minute, we could be talking to each other using our first names. So he could be calling me Mario, and I could be calling him Jake. And that's accepted. Yes? And that may be surprising with the fact about closeness and distance. Yes? Okay? British people tend to be very distant, and yet the fact that they mention your first name doesn't necessarily mean that they're trying to become close or anything. And it's a fact, yes? In fact, it's such a fact that within certain levels of a company, you can easily be talking to a managing director, obviously not your boss, because I think a boss here in Spain, you also call him by his first name. There's no problem with that, yeah? But somebody you don't know, who's in a specific level, he could be addressed by his first name in meetings, and different high-level, same-level counterparts could be addressing each other 5 minutes after meeting by saying hello, okay? And using the first names. Easy, no problem. Another difference, small talk. Do you know what's the small talk? The small talk is the ice-breaking sentences that you use before the meeting actually starts, where you really want to just say a few social words and make sure that everybody's relaxed, okay? Both cultures, in this case, use a small talk. But there are two main differences. One is regarding content, and another one is regarding time. Okay, which contents do Spanish people talk about in small talk? Sorry?
Weather or now the crisis.
Weather, football. Crisis, good. Football, what else? Sorry?
Women.
Good, if it's a men-only meeting, they usually talk about women. I don't know if it's a men and women, they also talk about women.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Yes, and women talk about men.
No, women.
Ah, okay. Okay. What else? Okay, those things are very typical, okay? Maybe you talk about traffic. Yes, traffic is also, sorry?
Traffic jam.
Yeah, exactly, sorry, traffic jams. Yeah, no traffic, traffic jams. And a few more things. What do you talk about in England?
Football.
Good, football?
Weather.
Another sport? Two more sports.
Rugby
and another sport?
Yeah,
cricket. Yes? You must talk about those three things. Especially because for some reason, obviously there is a reason, a cultural reason, cricket and rugby is associated to excellence. And it's very normal for successful businessmen in their CV to include which rugby teams they played for in their universities and which position you played at, because there is a direct relationship between your business capacities, according to them, between your business capacities and the position in which you played. Yes, okay? And it's a very respected aspect to have been a successful rugby player in school, high school, college, university. Okay? Is that associated in any way with any sport here in Spain? No, I don't think there's any sport that englobes this concept of excellence, yes? Well, the same happens in England with cricket, okay? So both for cricket and rugby, if you've been a rugby or a cricket player, you include it in your resume.
Yeah, it happens when you study at university. I don't remember the name, something
A grant?
No, I'm sorry. The business card.
Yes.
I'm engineering from this school.
Oh, okay.
And if I need people from this university, I will help you.
Ah, okay, good. Okay. But you, from this university, in this rugby team or in this football team or something, or not necessarily in sport? Nothing to do with sport? Yes, yes, okay, university, yes. However, something similar but in the opposite way may also be happening with universities now? That you belong, you go to this university, no thank you? Is it possible or not? I don't know, I'm asking. Could it work both ways, you know, in the same way? Yes, no? Like in all cultures, yeah? There's exactly. There's universities where you say, okay, you're from here, you're from there. Well, it helps me decide. It definitely helps me decide. Okay, good. Okay, so from the point of view of communication, that's another aspect that people tend to consider tremendously. All right? Space. Very different. The way you use the space, physical space, eh? Your social limits. This side of the class would be too close for a British student and for British people. They would need more space, okay? Which is a contradiction with many situations that with a couple of situations that I'm going to talk to you about now. But British people do not like to be as close to other people as in Mediterranean countries. They need the space. For example, queues. When you're queuing, when I have to queue, I feel somebody's breath on the back of my neck, quite often. Yes? And if I am the first, like imagine you've got the window at the bank, yes? Now there is a line on the floor which says wait here, which is usually all removed and everything because people carry on walking, because they tend to wait immediately behind the person who is at the window. So if somebody waits at the line, the person behind will say, ain't you gonna go? Yes, but I'm waiting. No, but there's space, come on, hurry up. And people like, if there is a space, you've got to occupy it. You've got to, okay? Whereas in Britain in general, people tend to stand in line, they to be further apart, okay? And it doesn't matter if there's whatever distance in the middle, that they consider it normal, and there is no physiological need to occupy that space immediately afterwards, okay? Okay? Yes, all right? This shows how people behave. Now, this means that when you're meeting somebody from another country, yes, British people will shake hands very much, how do you do, sir? Mm-hmm. Even with a straight arm, because this is, it hurts, you know, sort of thing, okay? So people will try to be very distant. How did two women greet in England, two women friends? They don't even kiss. They just say, hi, hello. And they're just two friends in a social event, okay? In business, two women, of course, will never kiss, and they will shake hands, just like men and women do, okay? In England, there's no difference between men and women regarding greeting in meetings, in business situations. What about Spain? Any kissing in Spain? Sometimes, yes, I find it quite often, but people tend to say that it's disappearing. Now, I imagine it depends the level of meeting. People will decide to shake hands or kiss, okay? But I still see quite a bit of kissing between men and women in business situations. Between women, I'm not sure. No. So is it, yes? Women as well. Okay, all right, okay. In England, no way. Nobody would kiss when you greet in a business situation. Okay? For example, I don't know, men, when you meet Your father, do you kiss him? Men, do you kiss your father when you meet him?
Nobody says.
If nobody, sorry?
No, I was joking, yes.
Yes? Yes? Yes. Nobody kisses his father if you're a man in England. You never kiss your father. Never.
It's a rule.
Absolutely. From when you're 14, from the moment you're 14 more or less, or earlier, you don't kiss your father. Never. Okay? Slap on the back. Okay? Between friends. Not even between friends in England a lot. Okay? Here in Spain, it's quite, you've got stereos and all going for that kind of thing. Exactly. How you doing? And you do that kind of thing. Okay? I will show you a video today where amazingly, even politicians do that in some cultures. Yes? And it's amazing, but they do it. And you notice how some people feel uncomfortable about it and some people don't. And it happens, yes? But this closeness does not happen in Britain at all. Okay? So it's very distant. However, contradictory points. You go to a fast food restaurant, and here in Spain, you sit on your little fast food table with four chairs, and usually you put your coat in one, your laptop bag on the other one, and your helmet on the other one, for example, and you sit on the fourth chair, and you're on your own eating. Okay? I ran into a lot of trouble the few years when I came here, because I used to sit next to people. I used to put the helmet on the table and say, good evening or good morning, and I used to sit there with them. And they used to go, what are you doing? This is my table. I'm sitting here, can't you see? It's not your table, I know you're sitting here, and that's why I said good evening, because I saw you and I wanted to sit with you, because there's no other tables. You should go to another table and stand up. No, but there's chairs. Yes, but they're occupied. Yes, but not by people. You know, chairs are for people, so not for bags and things. Blah, 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 blah. Okay? In England, it's very usual that even though people do not like to be together, they like to sit, even though I have nothing to do with you. I don't know you. I don't need to look at you. I don't need to speak to you. They could be that close. You would be eating your burger. You would be eating your fillet-o-fish, whatever. And they will be happily sharing a table. No more. Yes? Because the social space in England, it's simply a concept. It's not that physical. Okay? There is another situation. Do you agree that's a difference? Here in Spain, it's very difficult to share a table with someone when the table is small. Yes? Okay? In fact, what you see is one table with one person, and then another table with six chairs, and then another table with three chairs, and then some tables empty because there's no chairs for those tables. Yes, okay? But people don't share table unless they know each other. Okay? Second situation where that happens in England, in British environments, down the pub. Yes? When you go down the pub, many people after work go alone to drink. This is typical, you know? You don't need anyone to go and have a pint or 2 pints. After work. Okay, for 3 or 4 maybe you need somebody, yeah? Because you like to, I don't know, but you like. But for a couple of pints, it's very typical, or a wine, or whatever you want, you go down a pub and you sit on a table, at a table, sorry. And then I can assure you, pub tables are small. I'm sure you know. Yes, you know. So pub, and then with that, somebody will sit right next to you, and I mean almost touching knees, and you will just have your pub, your pint. Before, you would get out your cigarette. No more smoking allowed now, so no cigarette, and you would just stand there. You don't need eye contact. You don't need to you don't need to break the ice. You don't need anything. It's just my table. I'm just drinking alone, nothing more. And you could have 4 people, individual behavior, with nobody talking to each other. You do this in Spain, and if you are allowed to sit down, in 10 seconds, you've already got a conversation going, for sure.
5 seconds.
Yes? And this is, and you know, the eloquency of, and the communication of this type of culture that you don't need in many other countries. Because silence, for example, and this is a part of communication, silence is not a problem in England, even with your own family. Yes? When you watch, I'm not talking about football, but when you watch TV, and this is also a very individual thing, but people, it's very normal for a family in England to be watching TV and nobody says anything. Because if you talk, you can't listen. Remember, no multitasking, we can only do one thing at a time. We listen, and then we talk, and then we listen, and then we talk, but we can't do four things at the same time, okay? So over here, they see something on TV. Oh, did you see that? What did he say? I don't know, he was talking about what he said on television, so I don't know what they said on television because I didn't hear him. And this dynamic goes on and on and on, okay? Whereas over there, everybody's, they look bored just watching TV. Maybe they are bored, but they don't comment on what they watch. Okay, all right? This, the use of space and communication and time, is also a very clear different attitudes and behaviors. For example, something very obvious, cafeterias. Any cafeterias in England? There's no cafeterias in England.
No, well, more narrow coffee.
Sorry?
Narrow coffee shops.
Yeah, but that's a coffee shop.
Yeah.
Okay, but a coffee shop and a cafeteria is like a Starbucks. Starbucks is not a cafeteria. No way. It's a chill out area. But it's not a cafeteria. And remember, Starbucks are American. They're not British. Okay? So, which, and British and Americans are also very different from the point of view of time. And Americans are more similar to Spanish people. Yes? In many ways. In many, many ways. And you will see in the videos as well. Okay? Why don't you have cafeteria? What do you do in a cafeteria here in Spain? 10 o'clock. Let's go down for a coffee. Anybody coming? You're right. Quick coffee with you. Two coffees. 2 minutes? 5 minutes? Let's go back. Okay? And in 5 minutes, you've gone into the cafeteria, you've gone out, you've had your coffee. British people, what do you do that for? You can have your mug of coffee, you walk around with it. Your mug, eh? Not like in the USA, you've got your big cardboard cups. No, no, just your mug. And you carry your mug everywhere. You've got a meeting, you carry your mug, you're going to work, everywhere you need to go. And if you're going outdoors, you cover your mug with one of those special lids and then you drink it, but you've got your lid, okay? But you don't stop for a coffee. You don't. While you're working, while you're doing something, you have your coffee. Or you have your cup of tea, okay? But nothing else. And just like here in Spain, coffee helps to get you going, get the day going, and gets you thinking, etc. In England, quite a lot of people is tea. What do you do at 5 o'clock in a cricket game? You stop for tea. So in the World Championships, in many international competitions, you're playing cricket, and at 5 o'clock, everybody stops for a cup of tea. You stop for a cup of tea. It's a tradition they keep. Yes? Okay? And they do the same thing with a cup of tea. I had an accident on the bike when I was in England. I didn't break anything, but I ended up at the door of an old lady's house. She was doing her garden. And I said, I didn't even take my helmet off. I said, please, can you call somebody? I need help. I'm bad. I haven't broken anything, but please call the ambulance. So she said, don't worry, love, I'll help you, don't worry. So she went inside, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. I said, God, what are you doing? I said, so I sort of dragged myself. She comes out with a couple of cups of teas. All right, love, cup of tea for you, cup of tea for me. Now sit down and relax. I said, have you called the ambulance? Oh dear, I forgot, sorry about that. But you've got your cup of tea, don't worry. Cup of tea helps you, yeah? And with their time, that's what they do, okay? So in the same way as they do that, We've also got, you know, the tea that at any time, but no cafeterias, because you don't go there for just 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Stopping for lunch. Here in Spain, you have a meeting, and at 2:30, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, you stop for lunch. Yes? You have lunch. Usually you talk about business during lunch, and then you go back to the office and you continue with the meeting. Yes? Okay? You can't do that in England. So what do you do in England? You have a sandwich while you're at the meeting. So it's very usual, and it's not considered rude to be in a meeting, and while you are speaking to someone, someone's chewing away his sandwich with a bit of lettuce hanging out or whatever. You've got your napkin, clean yourself, and if you want to say something, I can assure you, more than once you will find people speaking with a mouthful. They will be speaking with a mouthful, and it's not considered rude in England. This is completely unthinkable in Spain. Right? Okay? Completely different. So, of course, you're going to get... This brings me to another of the cultural aspects. What's food like in Spain? What's food like in England? Full stop and we carry on. No, but this is clear. Yes? Okay? England, you've got your sausage roll, you've got your buns, you've got your crisps, and you've got your sandwiches, and that's lunch. Here in Spain, especially if it's an important meeting, you invite the other party, you have a nice lunch, you use it in a way as to get closer together, you enjoy the lunch, you try to impress the other party, then you go back to your business and you continue with the business. Yes? In England, you don't have time for that. They don't use the time for that. Which means that at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, everybody's home. Everybody's leaving. And so you go down London, and at 5 o'clock, Victoria Station, St. Pancras, Paddington Station, Waterloo, all those stations are packed with literally hundreds of thousands of people. Hundreds of thousands of people, because everybody has not stopped for lunch, because they have had probably their lunch while at a meeting, in a very casual way. Yes? Okay, so eating at a meeting, it's okay. It's not considered rude. Whereas here, it would be considered rude. Okay? All right? So again, space communication. Let's do another one. Power. How people... Let me just make sure that I've got that one. How people perceive power. What's the hierarchy like in a company? Okay? And how people use the perception of that power in order to be able to present some proposals to one person or to another person, or what to say to one person or to another person. Okay? In general, surprisingly for people that go abroad, British companies are very flat companies. But what happens is that after a certain level, there is a really big difference in the contact between the 80% or 90% of a company and the other higher 10%. And this is a fact in British companies. Which means that usually in organizations, and this is related with point number four, it's very typical that the leader, the manager, the boss of a team of people acts more as a coach than as a controller of tasks, okay? Although I am aware, and I think this is true, that now it's not so much about power, and it's not so much about, are you doing what you're doing, and you still haven't done this, and I'm just controlling you. It's more about talking and supporting and finding, as a team, solutions. And I think this is happening in many, many companies now, yes? Boss is not so much of a, you know, of a controller and saying, what are you doing? He's more of a coach and of another person of the team who helps with different decision capacities, but who also helps. Do you agree or not? Or do you still think there's places where, or there's possibilities where you find the, you know, the big power difference within a small team? No? Okay. All right. Individualism. Individualism means, let me do it. Individualism means that, not that people don't worry about team, but it means that there will be a high degree of importance given to whatever an individual has to do. Which means that apart from being in a team, nobody forgets what you are liable for. So if anything goes wrong, they will say, okay, have you got the solution? What happened? What are your plans? How are you going to act? You. Because you are the one in charge of this. And I know we're in the team, but it's not our responsibility. We're going to help you, but you're the one who has to take a decision on this, who's got to plan this, and who's got to analyze why this has happened. Okay? So the individual tasks and liabilities that you need are always present in British teams. Okay? Good. Competitiveness. Competitiveness means how do I, and this is very useful and very useful in negotiations, how do I perceive the threat of other parties when I am in a meeting, when I'm in a business situation? Is it really a threat? Is it a cooperation? What values does he have that I don't have? What has he got that I haven't got, that I need? And have I got what he needs? So competitiveness in this way, how can I say it with an English expression? If it's worth competing, British people will compete. But competing for the sake of it, because you're like heated up in the situation, they're never going to do it. Okay? So if for some reason they lose the competition because they believe that it's not worth going into that competition, they consider it adequate. Because, and this goes to the decision-taking process that we talked about, if they think that that decision is based on certain aspects that are not to their advantage, okay, they will not see it as a competition, but other cultures will say, okay, you've lost the competition, okay, in a situation, okay? The structures, as I mentioned before, is very much related to the hierarchy that I said before, okay, about individualisms, okay, and they tend to be very flat companies. Consider this also with the fact that we mentioned about British people using your first name right from the very beginning, okay, all right? Okay, and the thinking, which is the last part, which englobes many of the processes that we've been talking about, and especially the decision taken. Okay, I'm also looking at the fact that we've only got about 10 minutes, and I would like you to see the videos so that we can also have a look at practical terms what I'm talking about from the point of view of communication, social space, closeness, formality, informality, and the four points that we talked about in the beginning. Okay, let me have a look about social space in different cultures. Okay, this doesn't work with the video, so let me see if... Okay, this is what I talked about touching, not touching, okay? Now I'm just going to get here so you can see exactly what I'm... because I will be able to use the mouse control, okay? Just listen to the video at the beginning because it's very clear what the situation is, okay? Have you understood? You can't touch a queen. I'm sorry. Is that possible in Spain? I've seen the king do a bit of backslapping everywhere. Yes? Lots of backslapping here in Spain. Yes? Okay. Wow! With all due respect, not even Prince Philip got his hand there, you know, with all due respect, from the point of view that there is so close. In fact, it is the first time in history that anybody puts his hand or her hand on the Queen's left shoulder. in history. It has not been documented or recorded that anybody has been able to put a hand so close. Do you know who the lady is? Michelle Obama. Okay? And Michelle Obama has a very specific role in her life as the First Lady. And she's excellent at it. She's so good at it that she can even do it with the Brits. And that she can put her arm around the Queen when nobody else has done it. Okay? And yet, let me see if I can... Oh, I can't do it here. Now, that touch, it was measured and it took about 2 point something seconds. And look at the Queen's reaction. Look at her legs. She's clearly moving away from Michelle. Okay? Because English people do not like to be touched. Okay? And of all the protocol situations that this can be, this is one of those where you're more relaxed because there's like petit comités being formed around at different places in the room. You've got, you can see over here, a couple of important people, yes, that are having a chat while Michelle now not only puts her arm here, but now touches her right wrist. Okay, two in one, not bad. Okay, now you may not know this, but the Queen has specific medical instructions not to shake more than a certain number of hands per day. Because the National Health Service spent some money trying to see how much stress her hand undergoes throughout her life. Now she's 82. If you calculate the number of hands she's shaken during her life, apparently her hand will suffer a lot and has suffered a lot. So this and the fact that according to royal protocol, you can't touch the Queen is the perfect excuse not to touch the Queen, okay? Of course you touch the Queen when you shake hands. The Queen shakes hands with many people in the UK, okay? So the Queen is touched, okay? But there is a difference between, in fact, when maybe if you see when the Queen approaches crowds of people and little girls and boys give her flowers and everything, you will notice that there is, the most she does is, oh, good little boy. No, little pat on the head, and but there's no real closeness. She just takes the flowers, okay? She does that, okay? But this is a situation where you can see that, in fact, the Queen even walks away and looks another way instead of looking at Michelle. She looks at Michelle, okay? No more. That was it. But this was a premiere in royal history, okay? Because somebody decided to do that. But then again, her role is that one. And in fact, what do you think the English crowd's reaction was to this? You know, the English have a tradition for being very monarchist country, etc. What do you think the reaction was? They liked it or they didn't like it? They didn't like it? They loved it. They thought it was excellent. The Obama couple, they created what was called an Obamania. Obamania, okay? Because it was like people went crazy with all of the things they were doing. You know, people, things that the British people were not allowed to do, they were doing it publicly with the Prime Minister, with the Queen, etc. Okay? Okay. Another thing that I wanted to show you is how different, for example, this is. Do you know who this is? Good. Okay, so we're going to find two very different cultures to the British culture. Okay? Now, this is a great show of how even in a very important summit such as this one, people will culturally behave very different. Okay? Many things to look at. Whoa! Okay? Very close. Two backslaps. You could hear them. Okay? Now remember, this is also very American. Even though if you don't backslap, people who are relatively close, take your hand, bring it down, shoulder to shoulder. Yes? This is the equivalent in Spain of an embrace between two men. It's the equivalent. Okay? In the USA, they don't embrace with two arms, but they shake hands, and with the other one, they embrace, which is not bad. It's quite close as well. Yes? Neither of those two options are possible in England. Okay? Whether in this kind of protocol situation or in another situation. Okay? Now listen how Obama introduces his wife. Oh, you were looking at Berlusconi, yeah? Mamma mia, bella donna. But just before that, I was talking about the other person, okay? Who's the president of the USA, saying, my wife Michelle. My wife Michelle. Okay? That's the protocol. That was the president of the USA introducing his wife to the president of the Italian Republic. Okay? And so, what does Michelle Obama do? A couple of weeks earlier, she was hugging the Queen. Stay, boy. Stay. Straight arm. She wants no contact whatsoever. Exactly, of course. So she goes like this, two hands, welcome, see you later. So very distant. Why does she want to be so close sometimes, and why does she want to be so far away other times? Okay? Whereas her husband is very close. And if I showed you a video of Obama greeting the Queen, he's very distant. Yes? Okay? So from this point of view, the British and the Americans are very different, okay? Oh wow, I stopped it right in the place where everybody takes the photographs, yes? It's like, big smile, and third time lucky, and another one. Thank you very much. Yes, which for Berlusconi, it's okay, all right? Okay? I'll show you another thing, which is what you noticed at the beginning, which is a completely unacceptable way of behaving, yes? Say no more. Yes, there's no point. What's the point of doing that? Yes, okay, but this is a culture, because in some cultures, you need to show your feelings, okay? You need to show what you think about the other person. So what would negotiations be with Berlusconi like? He would love to know what you're feeling. Showing your feelings to this kind of person is not a handicap in this kind of culture. But showing your feelings in a British kind of culture could be a handicap. Showing your personal point of view about something when you're doing business with some cultures is an advantage, because showing your personal point of view can be used and will be accepted in one way or another by those people. Whereas in other cultures, your point of view, your personal point of view about something has nothing to do with business. So why are you mixing things up? This is what happened in British culture. You understand? I hope, okay, let me just finish. Actually, we've got a couple of things here. The understatement is similar to the passive in England, okay? The understatement means that, and this is a very used thing in England for communication, you express something which runs short of what you're really trying to describe on purpose. So it's completely the opposite of exaggerating, which is very common in Mediterranean cultures, but in England it's completely the opposite. Do not confuse with sarcasm. Do not confuse with euphemism. It's called an understatement, okay? So it's completely different. Let me give you a few examples, okay? Let me show you. Just a quick joke, okay? This is Mr. Wainscott. He's in charge of compliance. Okay? That's my understatement. This is reality. My understatement is he's in charge of compliance. Okay? A couple of examples so you can clearly understand. When Watson and Crick discovered, what did they discover? Good. They simply said, this is structure. People have put in double helix, but they didn't even say that. They said, this structure has novel features which are considerable biological interest. Oh, well, it turned out to be quite interesting and quite useful, okay? This is what Captain Lawrence Oates said before disappearing in the North Pole, okay? I'm just going outside and maybe some time, okay? An understatement, because, you know, it doesn't mean that you don't give it any importance, it just means that, you know, you give it, you're not as catastrophic or as dramatic as other cultures, okay? Typical, okay, Monty Python is full of understatements all over the films, and Monty Python is a clear example of English humor and English culture, not only English humor, okay? And that's what the Black Knight said in the Holy Grail. This is just a flesh wound, nothing else. And if you remember the film, he kept on kicking King Arthur because he wanted to carry on fighting, even though he had no arms to hold the sword, and he just kept on kicking him. And King Arthur said, leave me alone, you haven't got any arms. No, I want to fight. My courage is before my mind, you know. And he had no arms. This is just a flesh wound, nothing more. Okay? British humor, okay? And there are many studies on this, and the reason why British use humor in the meetings is because they want to show power. They want to show who can do the power. They want to emphasize obvious things, which is a kind of English exaggeration. Okay, if it's obvious, why do you mention it? Well, I exaggerate it, I emphasize it. Okay, and they want to somehow break the ice for difficult matters. Okay, and this, if you keep this in mind, cracking a joke at the right time could be an advantage. Okay, let me give you an example. Of all these three things, okay? And this is one more thing. English people will laugh at anything, at literally anything. They will laugh at religion, they will laugh at death, they will laugh at their mothers, they will laugh at their fathers, they will laugh at how bad they are at doing something. They will laugh at body parts of men and women. They will laugh at things that are not accepted in many cultures. British people will. So feel free, because they will accept it. It will not sound strange. Where I think in other cultures, royal family. English people have been laughing at royal family, the British royal family, for a long, long time. This is an aspect which here in Spain is not accepted at all. Yes? Okay? As simple as that. Yes? No, no, but remember the big issue they had with La Revista El Jueves and all this a couple of years ago, yes? So there's obviously a lot of problem. In fact, if you remember, it's not Los Teleñecos. What do you call these? The Muppets that looked like real people. What was it called? El Guiñol. Okay, in England, you had Muppets of absolutely all the members of the royal family. What was Charles like? What was the Queen Mother like? All the way. It's accepted things. And you laugh at that because it's part of humor. Okay? Power. How do people show power? Okay. Formal or informal? I'm feeling inadequate. Formal. Informal, I'm pissed off. Sending someone to humiliate, because I've got the power. Okay? All right. This is a bit long, but it's interesting. The anger management consultants said he was going to alert his fucking dates at his fucking stage, which fits in with the managing change consultant, who said it was too late to change. Okay? But none of this matters because the maximize your efficiency consultant forgot to do the booking. Yes? So this means that not everybody, I mean, they laugh at their own faults. Yes? As something that it's clear in English people, okay? And this is how you set achievable targets in Britain, okay? So you agree, we'll put aside plans for ending poverty in the world, we will not develop faster than light travel, And we'll see what we can do about meeting our sales targets. So this is decision taking. Difficult things, no. Let's do the easy things. Let's see what we can do with this. And the other things, let's see if we're not going to be able to do it, okay? Okay, how to introduce a difficult subject, okay? As it says here, the economic forecast is difficult for an amateur to get right, but us professionals, oof, you know, we are reasonably confident that the markets will go either up or down in the long or short term. Yeah, you know, I'm not afraid to talk about difficult things, okay? Not at all. And I'd just like to finish with this. I'd like to thank you for at least showing some interest in this, is that, and this is again Richard Lewis who said it, the person who did the triangle classification of the countries. He's found a very nice way of describing the perfect European by taking a little piece of an identity which represents different communities around Europe. And he said, okay, imagine him, yes, diplomatic as a Brit, thorough as a German, logical as a French, humanistic as a Spaniard, communicative as an Italian, yes, negotiating like a Portuguese, wheeling and dealing like a Greek. How much you want for this? 20, no, 30, no, 40. What for this? Leave off, come on, 35, okay? Humorous as an Irishman, pleasant as a Dane, conscientious seeking as a Swede, compromising as a Belgian, committed, compromising, okay? Honest as a Dutchman, bustling as a Luxembourger, bustling, energetic, okay? Sophisticated as an Austrian, commonsensical as a Finn, heroic as a Bulgarian, cultured as a Pole, streetwise as a Hungarian, knowledgeable as a Czech, proud as a Slovak, well-organized as a Slovenian, poetic as a Romanian? No? Yeah? Okay, yeah, good, okay. Quietly confident as Estonian, cool as a Latvian, spirited as a Lithuanian, full of stamina as a Maltese, and savvy as a Cypriot. So you see, what he's trying to say is that everybody has got positive aspects that you can use to do business with, okay? Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it, okay? Thanks.